mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy. Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Well, we're continuing in our study in Luke. We're in Luke chapter 6 today, so if you want to take a moment and open your Bibles. And I wanted to actually give a special shout out. Our church friends and family from Resolve Bible Church in California They sent us a special gift. They saw how our recordings were going, and so they sent us a gift that we're using as of today and Sunday's message as well, this camera. And so we want to say thank you to them because they've blessed us immensely with that. And it's amazing because we were using some cameras that that had their own sleep timers on them, and so so we had the cameras, you'd sometimes hear them beeping in the background. That's when they were cutting out on their timers and have to be restarted immediately. So a lot of fun stuff that we were doing between using cameras and using computers to record everything. So we're very thankful and for this tool that we've been given, and we want to make sure we use it well, but you know, just want to give a very special thanks to Pastor Rudy and Elder Danny and Pastor Nash and their generosity there at Resolve Bible Church, and say thank you to them. Well, as we are going into Luke chapter 6, we're continuing with some of the thoughts that that have to do with it being a new ministry. If you remember where we left off, Jesus had given them a bit of a parable because there was a question about why were his disciples not fasting when the Pharisees and their disciples were, and John the Baptizer and his disciples were, and he explains that it's because he's the bridegroom, and how could they fast right now, and then talk to them about how they're trying to get this new ministry, the new covenant ministry, to fit into the old, whereas it can't happen. And so that idea extends into this next section. I wish I could have just done it all in one, but we specifically have some Sabbath day issues that happen here at the beginning of chapter 6. There's two miracles that occur, and they're examples of the old covenant method that the Pharisees are relying on and even have expanded on to their own advantage in their own ways, with their fence laws that aren't actually part of the law. Those don't work with the new covenant, and because the new covenant is based on the greater part of the law, which is love the Lord your God with your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor. And so that being the core aspect of the law, of the new covenant, which is also the core aspect of the law of the old covenant, but the new covenant is captured in that, in Christ. And the old covenant then is wrapped into it, but the old covenant can't wrap around the new covenant. And so that's where you have the parable that he gave of the cloth, the old cloth and new cloth, and the old wineskin with the new wine in it. So let's go ahead and take a look at Luke chapter 6. And actually, as we do that, let's pray and open our time. Lord, thank you so much that we can join together in studying your word today. We thank you that you have preserved this gospel written by Luke. And that in doing that, Lord, you've made sure that not just was it preserved, but then all of your grace and goodness in making it so it's available to us in English. And it's available in so many different languages now. And we thank you for that. We thank you that translation work continues on, that your word can be spread throughout this world. But we particularly are thankful today because it's in a language we understand, that we can read, that we can learn. And so we're amazed by that, because now we get to see Jesus, our Savior, in a real way. And not just hear others tell about it, but we can study every day about our Savior. So I pray that you would, that you would be seen more clearly, more beautifully, more amazingly, more magnificently before our eyes today as we read through Luke, and that you would affect our hearts in that we would love you and worship you with everything we have. And so lead us now through this time by your Holy Spirit. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Luke chapter 6, starting in verse 1. On a Sabbath, while Jesus was going through the grain fields, his disciples plucked and ate some heads of grain, rubbing them in their hands. But some of the Pharisees said, "Why are you doing what is not lawful to do on the Sabbath?" Jesus answered them, "Have you not read what David did when he was hungry, he and those who were with him? How he entered the house of God and took and ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for any but the priests to eat, and also gave it to those with him? And Jesus said to them, "The Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath." We'll stop right there, and then we'll go to the next section in just a moment. But as we look at this, we notice that Luke is very clear on this section and the next one that this is happening on a Sabbath. And so there's specific challenges to the authority of the Pharisees. The Pharisees are following along with Jesus and his disciples. And that's obvious because they're out in the field with Jesus and his disciples looking for, and we get the sense, and we'll get more of a sense of it as we keep going through Luke, that they're looking to try and trap Jesus a bit. And so on the Sabbath, there were definitely some restrictions on the Sabbath. And those are very clear, that the idea is that the Sabbath is a day set apart for the Lord, not for our common work. Not for us to do just the things that are just normal every day, but a day that we dedicate to the Lord for worship. And Jesus is also clear in other passages that it's a day for us to rest. It's a day of rest. For 6 days you are to work, and the seventh day you are to rest. And God gives the example, though he didn't need rest, we need rest, but he didn't need rest. But in 6 days of creation, he made everything. The seventh day, he rested, and that becomes an example to us of a day of rest each week, and that becomes that creation ordinance carries through for us even today. Not because we have to keep specific Sabbath laws as they did in the Old Testament, but because we are human and we are weak, and we need rest, we need sleep, we need those things, and God knows that. He's gracious, and he knows that we are but man. And because of that, he tells us what's healthy for us. What's healthy for us is to have a day set apart, but not just a day to be lazy, but a day set apart to worship him and honor him and keep our hearts focused on him in a very specific and special way, as a constant reminder of his grace and his goodness. He's given us that day as a gift to us. That's one more grace that he's given. And so with that in mind, there are restrictions that are there, but more restrictions were made so that they're what I'd call fence laws. And fence laws are, if the law is here, then we put a fence out here so that if we break the fence law, we stop right there, but we don't go all the way to this law. We don't actually break the real law. And so an example of one of the fence laws that we see in the Old Testament all the time is that instead of writing the name Yahweh into the text, they would just put the consonants in. And when they come to those portions of the text, instead of reading out the name Yahweh, what they would read is they would read the name, or they'd read Jehovah. They'd read a number of different ways. They would do a number of different things to keep themselves from saying the Lord's name. And the idea was to keep themselves from breaking the commandment that says, "You shall not take the Lord's name in vain." And their fear was that someone was going to say it without fully comprehending, understanding, and reverencing the name of the Lord. And so, did they need to do that? No, they could. If you're reading scripture, you can read the Lord's name. As long as you're being respectful and honoring to his name, you may use his name. And that's why when we're reading the Old Testament, I use Yahweh when I see the where that's supposed to be. I try and put that in there so we actually see his name being used instead. But that was a fence law. Nobody, they didn't have to do that. They did that to keep themselves from breaking the actual law, which the actual law was don't take the Lord's name in vain, which is a hard issue, first and foremost, of reverencing God in everything that we do. So that's an example of a fence. There were some ones that had to do with the Sabbath, and they had to do with what you could and couldn't do on the Sabbath, what constituted work. And they had all these regulations that said, this constitutes work, this constitutes work, this constitutes work. One of the things that they had in there was reaping or harvesting and threshing were forms of work, which there are forms of work. And they defined it down enough so that what the disciples are doing would constitute being breaking the Sabbath in the Pharisees' mind, because they were reaping harvest and they were threshing, which is to take the wheat and to break off the chaff so you can eat the wheat berries. And so the way they did it was they would take off the stalk and they'd just rub it in their hands, and then the chaff would fall off and they'd have the wheat berries left, and they could eat that. They could eat those greens, right? So that is what they were doing, and they're doing that of picking a couple of heads off and rubbing it in their hands and then eating the wheat berries for food. While it's allowed in the Old Testament for the sojourners to go through the fields as long as they are not doing a full reaping, but they can take a little bit and eat as they go. That's one of the mercies that God has given. And so they did that, and then by rubbing their hands, they were threshing the wheat. Where usually threshing the wheat is happening in a big barn area, and they're really crunching a whole bunch of wheat and then allowing the wind to blow out all the chaff and then burn that off, and then what's left is the berries. So so what they did was, as they plucked and ate some heads of grain and rubbed them in their hands, the Pharisees said, "Why are you doing what's not lawful on the Sabbath?" And it's what they said was not lawful, and it has to do with fence laws. It's not actually breaking the Sabbath. Now, Jesus doesn't explain that to them. He could have said, well, that's actually not what the law says. Instead, he goes to a heart issue for them instead. The heart issue for them is not about the Sabbath law itself. The heart issue is their view of people and their care of people. And so, and where they put their laws in alignment with where they put people. And the idea is that they've forgotten that God's laws are meant to be centered around love the Lord your God with all everything you have, and love others, love your neighbors as yourself. And here they'd be breaking that part of loving your neighbor as yourself. Okay, so you're hungry. You should be able to eat something, even if it's a Sabbath. As a sojourner, you should be able to eat something, and this would be merciful to you, right? So where Jesus brings them to, in verse 3, and Jesus answered them, "Have you not read what David did when he was hungry, he and those who were with him? How he entered the house of God and took and ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for any but the priest to eat, and also gave it to those with him." And so he takes them back to a story that happens in 1 Samuel, where David is fleeing from the presence of Saul. Last minute, he leaves everything behind, even leaves a sword behind. And he and the young men who are following with him, they come to the priest at the tabernacle. And David says, "Look, we left. We were," and he makes up a story about why he's gone. And with it, then he says, "We need food." And the priest says, "All we have is the showbread that's been on the table, which is only lawful for the priest to eat. The new gets set out tomorrow, so you may have this." And so the priest shares the leftover showbread with David, which is not to be eaten by anybody but priests, and yet. Jesus points to it and says, "Look, this was acceptable. This was allowed, and Jewish teaching would have said that was acceptable. That was an act of mercy toward David and to his companions to feed David and care for him in that way, with whatever you had in that case. It was an extenuating circumstance that, while it officially broke the law, it was allowed because the mercy for other people superseded that." The care for the people did. So we want to be careful, because people can take this all sorts of ways. People do take it all sorts of ways, right? People do all sorts of things in the name of loving others that we know are absolutely against Scripture, and are unloving because of that. Because you're leading people toward condemnation under God, toward God's wrath, by allowing that. So we want to be careful that we're not just like cutting everything and saying, "Well, mercy and love come about everything." No, God is a God who is true, and His laws reflect His very character. So when you break His law, you really are dealing with His character. And so we have to be very aware of what's happening. But the heart of the priest in that case was a heart of mercy toward David. And so what he did was forgive him, and acceptable in that case. And so Jesus calls them to remember that story and say, "Wait, how merciful are you being about a law really that isn't even there? it's your law. It's not even God's law. They're not actually breaking anything, any true law of God. You're not being merciful at all. You're lacking love for them. So that's what we have, the first area, right? And so the things we want to pull out of this is Jesus putting forward this new covenant ministry that's coming, the ministry of the kingdom of God, the kingdom being at hand. The entrance of the kingdom in this new covenant ministry, it is that new wine that can't go in the old wineskin. And so, because there's a heart transformation that has to come, and that's what we see in Jeremiah, right? A heart of flesh replaces the heart of stone that's in us. And that's what Jesus is calling the Pharisees to have. You need to have a heart of flesh. You need to be merciful and kind and gracious, and not be just strictly judgmental of it. Now, if they normally were harvesters and reapers, and they did this on a Sabbath, then they would be breaking the law. There's no doubt about that. But as sojourners, they were allowed this mercy in Deuteronomy. They were given this mercy to do. And what are they going to do? Okay, you can harvest it on a Sabbath, but you can't eat it because you can't thresh it. Doesn't make sense. So the very fact of what they were doing fit the merciful aspect of the law and didn't break the Sabbath because of that. There are other places where Jesus deals with them on the Sabbath, but this is an important teaching for us to get. And then where he goes to then is interesting, because once again, he doesn't go and explain to them why it would be lawful for them to do this. Instead, verse 5, and he said to them, the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. So what he says, ultimately, I have authority over the Sabbath. So what I say goes. And what we have to remember is that Jesus is not just Lord of the Sabbath. He is our Sabbath rest. We see that in Hebrews 3 and 4. He is our Sabbath rest. He is that true rest that we enter into in Christ. We rest from all of our works and work. So we strive to enter that rest, as the writer of Hebrews says, and striving into that rest in belief and trust and resting in him. He is that Sabbath rest for us. But he is Lord of the Sabbath. And so because of that, he is the one who dictates with authority what is acceptable and what isn't for worship. And it's right, because he is God. And so he's the one that you're supposed to be worshiping on the Sabbath. So he obviously can decide, this is worshipful and this is not to me. And so that's his authority. So once again, as we're going through this, we see some different aspects that are running through. One is that authority aspect. Jesus has been authoritative over many things. And now we see that he is authoritative over the Sabbath. He has authority over demons. He has authority over disease. He has authority over nature. He has authority over the Sabbath and the regulations of the Sabbath as the Son of Man. Verse 6, on another Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and was teaching, and a man was there whose right hand was withered. And the scribes and the Pharisees watched him to see whether he would heal on the Sabbath, so that they might find a reason to accuse him. But Jesus knew their thoughts, and he said to the man with the withered hand, come and stand here. And he rose and stood there, and Jesus said to them, I ask you, is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do harm, to save life or to destroy it? And after looking around at them all, he said to them, to the man, stretch out your hand. And he did so, and his hand was restored. But they were filled with fury and discussed with one another what they might do to Jesus. So in this section, we have an extension of the same idea of the mercy of the Sabbath. And here, on another Sabbath, Jesus is now back in a synagogue teaching. We saw that earlier on a couple of different times where Jesus was in the synagogue teaching. Now he's back in a synagogue teaching on a Sabbath. And you'll notice that the scribes and Pharisees know that Jesus is going to see this man who has a withered hand and is going to respond to that with compassion. They're expecting it. They've set it all up so that they can bring accusation. You see that right there, that the scribes and Pharisees watched him to see whether he would heal on the Sabbath. They had this planned out and worked. Look, this man's here, he's got a withered hand. Let's see if Jesus is going to do this. And the inference there is that they know Jesus' heart is to do it, which in that inference is also a condemnation of themselves. This is the heart that God wants to have. To seek that mercy for others, to be merciful, to be just with other people, realizing that we're all sinners and we need to deal justly. What's better for our man who's with a withered hand? To have a withered hand or not to have a withered hand? To have a healed hand? And they would, for themselves, they'd want the healed hand, and yet for this man, let him stay withered. And we see that they were watching that in verse 7 so that they might find a reason to accuse him. So we have their heart issue, their hearts laid out here. We have what they've set out, and we see their hearts on display. And with it, they've condemned themselves. And so Jesus, he knows their thoughts, and he doesn't back away from it. Instead, he steps into the confrontation, and he invites the man front and center. Hey, come on up over here, right in the middle. Now nobody can ignore what's going to happen. He brings the man forward. And we have in Mark and Matthew in this account, we have a very clear frustration of Jesus as he calls on them to see this man and have mercy on him. And they don't. And Luke doesn't bring that out here, but the idea of the mercy of the account is an important aspect of it, even though he doesn't use the words like compassion. He doesn't talk about Jesus getting upset with them because of their hardness of heart. But he knows their thoughts. That's part of what he can do as God. He lays that aside for most of his ministry, but in this case, his divine prerogative to, at this point, I'm going to know what they're thinking. And he does. You know, there's other times where it's the Spirit that prompts him and tells and leads him in knowing those things. But here, very clearly, Luke is saying, okay, we've talked about him being man, talking about being man, being reliant upon the Spirit, still having the authority, but now we actually see him using divine prerogative of, I know the thoughts. I know the hearts. And so, so Jesus asked them the question, I ask you, is it lawful in the Sabbath to do good or do harm, to save life or to destroy it? And so that's where he brings them to, is they have to decide. And they will not answer him. And that there's just, you can just picture this cold silence. The man sitting there, standing there with his withered hand. Jesus is asking them this hard question. Not that hard, shouldn't be hard. Well, yeah, of course it's better on the Sabbath to do good, not to do evil. To give life, not to give death. And that's common sense. There's an easy answer to that, but they won't answer that. Because what they want is they want judgment that they can bring. They want to bring accusation against him. So Jesus tells the man to stretch out his hand. And you'll notice the faith of the man isn't like, well, my hand doesn't stretch out. The man just takes his hand and stretches it out, and as he stretches it out, it's healed. So you see the trust and faith of the man as he follows Jesus, as he does what Jesus says. And so there's something about where the man already was trusting Jesus in this and knew Jesus would bring healing. There was Jesus who was bringing this confrontation right in front of them, and yet he doesn't lift a hand. He doesn't do anything. There's no way they could say that he did anything at that point. He just tells the man to lift up his hand and stretch it out. And he's healed. There's no work done physically. And somebody raising your hand is not considered work on a Sabbath, right? And yet the man is healed. And so they're frustrated. And you can see that at the end, right? They're filled with fury. And they discuss with one another what they might do to Jesus. How can they do? What are they going to do? They can't bring accusation because they didn't do anything they could see. And so there, you can see their frustration, which is further displaying their hearts, which is their hardness against all the people around them, not just against Jesus, because how could they be so hard and cold and cruel to want this man to stay with a withered hand and not be able to work because of that, and not be able to care for his family, and not be able to be part of society because of that, not be able to be able to go to the temple when it comes time for the feast. All those things that, that his withered hand would cause, and they're hard against him. They despise him as a person. And that hardness of heart comes out very clearly in this passage. And so, what we have then is we have two accounts that display the new covenant ministry of Jesus. And both of them point very directly at the law is upheld through mercy. And that's an amazing thing about this. And so capture this in this, that Jesus is saying that this is how the law is upheld. The covenant is upheld through mercy. And that's what the new covenant brings, is mercy and love for others and abiding by God's law. We don't deny the law of God. We uphold the law of God by loving others, by being merciful to them, by granting them that mercy and care, and by having that heart for people in that way. That compassion. So that leads us then to have a couple things to think about. One is, people get caught up in all this about what you can do and can't do on a Sunday. Let me first tell you, Sunday is not a Sabbath. The Sabbath is a Saturday. So we no longer are under those Sabbath regulations because Jesus is our Sabbath. We worship on Sunday, the Lord's Day, as a resurrection celebration day. If we're still under the Sabbath requirement, we would still have to worship on Saturdays. We're not. Jesus has freed us from that Sabbath day. Matter of fact, Paul has a long discussion about it in Romans chapter 14, where there's some where a special day, a certain day is special, and some where every day is. Either one works, they're all unto the Lord. That's the idea. Every day is unto the Lord. Because Jesus is our Sabbath rest, we go to him and rest in him, and so we have our Sabbath rest. But we are still human, and so the creation requirement of to work 6 days and rest on one day doesn't change, because we have not stopped being human. And God in his mercy and grace has given us the Sabbath as a gift to us. The Sabbath is for us, not us for the Sabbath. And so we are to rest then and know that Jesus is the Lord of our Sabbath, and he is our Sabbath. And if we go to a day of rest, that day of rest is only a day of rest if it's a day of rest in Christ. If we're not resting in Christ, we haven't actually experienced that rest. And so that's the challenge for us, not whether you go to multiple services on a Sunday, or whether you're allowed to go play sports, or whether you're allowed to do this or that. All the different requirements that have been out there in the past about what should happen and shouldn't happen on a Sunday. The reality is, we're to have a day of rest. That day of rest is to be focused on Christ and resting in Christ. And as a church, it is best for us to have a single day together where we can also join together and remind ourselves and stir ourselves up in worship. And so Sunday works really well. But there's also, there are those who cannot take a Sunday off. That isn't their day of rest. Even if they come to church, maybe they work afterwards. That doesn't mean that they're breaking the rest requirements. As long as they take another day and they're resting. What's best is if we can all rest on the same day and enjoy fellowship together throughout that day and enjoy the fruits of being the family of God together. But that's not how everything works. And there's freedom in us in this so that we don't have to be that way. And so we're not dogmatic about it, but we also like the best thing, which is for all of us to be able to be together multiple times and to have time for going to people's houses and enjoying fellowship together. All those things are gifts from God as a church family. And so that's what we want. We want that type of rest. And our rest is that we have a day of rest because we need a physical day of rest because we're human. But more than that, our every day is resting in Christ alone. He is our Sabbath rest. And we rest from our works because it's his work that makes us right with the Lord, right with God. And it's his mediation for us that gives us access to the Father And it's not by any works of ours. It's not by works of righteousness that we've done, but according to his mercies, he has saved us. So that's the first part, as we think about the requirements of Lord's days, Sundays. It doesn't change, though, that we should treat it as a special day. And so we recognize it as a special worship day and honor it and set it apart as much as we can. And if we can't on that day, we find a day and we still keep ourselves connected to our church family. For we need that. That's part of requirements of us as brothers and sisters in Christ. And so, so with Jesus being our rest, we're also reminded that then both the rest day and every other day are days to bring his mercy and compassion to others. That's what the rest day is for, is to remind us of the mercy we've received, and that's the mercy that we then give to others. The love we receive, that's the love and forgiveness that we give to others. And so that's a true Sabbath rest. And so we are part of that new covenant community in Christ, and that new covenant community in Christ does not look for rules and regulations to make our day holy and right. Instead, looks for ways to enjoy the fellowship of Jesus Christ, to rest in him and his work, and to find ways to be merciful and gracious and loving toward others because of the great love with which we've been loved. May that be the way that you have your Sabbath rest, and may you enjoy that rest in him. So let's go ahead and close in prayer, and I pray that you would continue studying and thinking about this. And if you have questions about it, or think I pulled something a little strange, let's talk about it, because I want to make this a conversation as we keep learning about Jesus together. Father, thank you so much for Jesus, our Sabbath rest. Thank you that he is the Lord of the Sabbath. Because of that, his requirements of mercy and grace and kindness override everything else. And it's about your worship, Jesus. You being glorified and magnified. And you're magnified as we love others. But you're magnified also as we set aside time and as church family come together and worship, and as individuals even, to take time to quietly be alone with you. And so I pray that you would help us to truly enjoy that rest in you. That rest once a week, but that rest daily as well, though every time and any time we can come to your presence and rest in you. So thank you so much for this time that we've had in your word. I pray that you be glorified and blessed and honored as we continue to learn more about you. Grow us in our love for you. We give you thanks and praise, Jesus. Amen. May God bless you today.